All right, it is past five, so I think it's time to start. So hello everyone, and welcome to this second talk in our Physics and Machine Learning seminar. Today we welcome Dr. Tim Green from DeepMind. Tim studied natural sciences at the other place before moving here to Oxford to study for a DPhil in the Department of Materials with Professor Yates in the Materials Modeling Laboratory. For his thesis entitled Prediction of NMR J Couplings in Condensed Matter, he developed computational modeling with density functional theory. He did his postdoc with the same group before joining DeepMind as a research engineer. Since joining, he has worked on computer vision, deep reinforcement learning, and protein folding. He is now the lead research engineer for the AlphaFold team. AlphaFold is a novel machine learning approach developed at DeepMind to predict the three-dimensional structure that a protein will adopt based solely on its amino acid sequence. This has been an important open research problem for more than 50 years. DeepMind's novel approach demonstrated accuracy competitive with experimental structures in the majority of cases and greatly outperforms other methods in the majority of other cases. It has caused a paradigm shift to the field of structural biology and has since been recognized as Method of the Year 2021 by Nature Methods. It is ranked easily among the most important scientific achievement of the last few years. So it's a great honor to have Dr. Tim Green.
Brilliant, thank you very much. Can you hear me okay? And can you see the slides?
Thank you, Tim, for accepting to give us a talk on this interesting topic, and the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Brilliant. Cool. So I'm going to hit, thanks for the introduction. And I'm here today to talk about AlphaFold. So highly accurate protein structure prediction with AlphaFold. And this is, I'll do a bit of acknowledgement later on, but here are a range of the people who are on the paper and who all works on it. So just give an introduction. So yeah, again, about me. So Maxence supposed to bit, cover this stuff. So if you want to email me, there's my email address at DeepMind. So Cambridge Physics, and then realized the error of my ways and came to Oxford. Then I stayed at Oxford a bit longer, and then finally I joined DeepMind in 2016. And since then I've worked on a range of things, computer vision, population-based training, DeepRL. You can see in the corner a bit of a picture of some agents playing CTF with each other in a sort of Quake 3 type environment. Bit of ML infrastructure, so I worked on a Sonnet, a TensorFlow a layer abstraction library. And then finally, I sort of started working on protein structure prediction about 2017 or so. And ever since, I've been working on this really interesting problem. So a central part of DeepMind's mission is to solve fundamental scientific problems with AI. DeepMind's mission, I think, is solve intelligence and apply it to scientific and social challenges. And what this is predicting the 3D structure of proteins from its amino acid sequence is one of these big fundamental scientific challenges. And AlphaFold is our model that aims to solve this problem. So what are proteins? Proteins are molecular machines that are essential to life. They have many functions. For our hair is made of a protein called keratin. So our immune system, which is this incredibly complex, sort of practically a biological computer, which defends us against all sorts of pathogens. And has been in the news a lot recently, obviously. And so proteins consist of chains of amino acids, they're polymers, and these polymers fold into a 3D structure. So on the right, I sort of show a little cartoon sketch of what the backbone of one of these proteins looks like. You have a carbon, you have another carbon, you have nitrogen, then it continues for how many residues you have. And then you also have these little side chains hanging off, which give the protein all its interesting chemical properties. And the exact 3D shape that protein folds to, it's important for its function. So the shape usually acts as some sort of framework that allows the right bits of the sort of side chains of the amino acids with the right chemical properties to be in the right place at the right time in order to, say, bind to another molecule or bind to another protein or force some sort of conformational change or all sorts of things. The 3D structure is very important. And understanding protein structure is a fundamental problem in biology, and this is why we're interested in doing it. And so why predict protein structures? So why not just work them out experimentally? So working out the structure of protein experimentally can take months to years. One of my housemates spent her entire four-year PhD trying to get the structure of one protein and managed in the last 6 months and got a Nature paper. And that's like some take longer, some take a bit faster, but it is generally a really big task. Like, so, several researchers for several years quite often. And structure prediction can provide actual information faster. So we won't necessarily be as accurate, but often we are, as experiment, but we can do it in seconds to minutes to maybe up to hours rather than months or years. So you can skip all of these different steps, each of which can be very challenging, even interpreting the data. So once you've got the protein crystals, X-ray diffracted them, you then have this problem of trying to actually turn the data into 3D structure, which it turns out I recently learned is actually not that easy because you only get half the data, you're missing all the phase information. So this problem called the phase problem, which you need to solve in order to actually get a 3D structure. And so by doing structure prediction, we try to circumvent this entire process and just go directly to predicting the structure. And actually I'll talk a bit later about how predicting structure can actually help the experimental process as well. So today I'm going to introduce myself, I just have. So I'm going to talk a bit about how AlphaFold works. I'm going to talk a bit about how we think AlphaFold builds protein structures. I'm going to talk a bit about its impacts, and we'll give an update on a follow-on paper we did called AlphaFold Multimer. And then I'm going to briefly summarize at the end about AI for science. Okay, so how AlphaFold works. So the main intuition that I think is useful to have of sort of why something like AlphaFold is possible at the moment is this influence of a protein structure on its function and then how it interacts with evolution. So a protein has some structure, a protein has some function, like it might catalyze some reaction. And then as a protein evolves, so it's an organism's DNA changes, it branches into new species, these genes pick up various mutations, these mutations in the genes change the amino acids in the protein structure, they might insert, delete, or change amino acids. And these new proteins, which are slightly different from their sort of ancestors' proteins, will be a bit different. It might have, they might function better, or they might function the same, or they might function worse. And evolution selects which ones are fit. So it'll probably filter out the bad mutations, and you'll no longer see those present in sort of in nature. So what this basically intuition gets us to is that the protein sequences we see in nature are the ones which have been deemed to be fit, probably because they conserve the function of the protein. They probably conserve the function of the protein because they conserve its structure. So if we take a protein sequence and look for all the similar sequences in nature to that sequence by some sort of sequence alignment tool, all these sequences which are similar to this one, they will probably have the same structure. And we can actually use this in a very important way, is that the way in which mutations are preserved as being fit tells us a lot about the protein structure. So for example, often you might see that two residues mutate in a correlated fashion. So if one mutates, the other mutates, and that will tend to mean that, why would you do that? Probably the reason is that those two residues are close to each other in 3D space. So this allows us to kind of invert the causality here and go from which sequences have been conserved by evolution to what is the structure that actually we're trying to conserve in order to retain its function that ensures its fitness. So AlphaFold, its inputs and outputs, I think it's a good place to start for machine learning models, is a amino acid sequence. So this is a 20 letter alphabet, a sequence of tens to hundreds to maybe up to a few thousand letters representing the polymer chain in which amino acids are put in sequence. And then we have the evolution related sequences. So these are sequences which are found in databases of protein sequences, which are similar under some alignment metric. So you can see there, what we've done is these tools will take your sequence and find similar sequences and align them so that the things which are the same all occur in the same column. And then you also get told what the insertions, deletions, and changes are. So we have this thing called multiple sequence alignments. And that will usually, what conventionally people do is use these more classical tools, will look for correlation directly in this multiple sequence alignment. So sort of say, oh, this column varies, well, this column varies. Unfortunately, there are some confounding effects and it's a bit complex. So what we do is we actually just give this multiple sequence alignment directly to AlphaFold and let it work it out itself rather than trying to handcraft anything. And then the training data. So there is about 170,000 known experimental protein structures. These being determined by, as I sort of explained, like laborious experimental work by thousands of researchers over decades, really. And that sort of represents a massive culmination of structural biochemistry. and there's about 40,000 after you deduplicate quite similar structures. Another thing we do, which I'll probably talk a bit more detail later, is we use something called distillation. So we actually predict the structure of an additional 350,000 sequences of unknown structure and then use those as though they were training data. And then the output of the model is that we predict a 3D position of every atom in a protein. So there's up to somewhere between a few hundred and tens of thousands of atoms in one of these proteins. So another thought when we're sort of thinking about building AlphaFold is about inductive bias. So in deep learning, one of the nice ways to think about things is how the information flows around. So not, you might have seen something a bit like this before, but we have a, say, convolutional network, we have data in a regular grid, it's translationally equivariant, and information flows to your local neighborhood. You have like a patch of your receptive field for every activation neuron in a layer. And this is what we use in our Fold 1. So this basically is going to be best at learning rules, which involve local information within the receptive field. And basically, the better your inductive bias is suited to your problem, the easier it will be for you to use that data. You'll be able to use less data to learn a better model that learns about the rules that generated that data. So another example of an inductive bias would be recurrent networks. So for example, in language, where we has a inductive bias that things are have a sequence order, so things go in recurrent sequence, and also that probably that things in the more recent past have greater influence in information terms than in the distant past. You have graph networks, so you have this fixed structure, and then information flows along the fixed edges. So you have an inductive bias to pay attention to your nearest neighbors more than distant nodes in the graph. And then finally, there's another sort of inductive bias in deep learning for attention. It's often used language models, which is what we use in AlphaFold too, where you could say that we have sort of data in an unordered set, and then you sort of have, say, think about edges between the items of the set and your this neuron, and these edges are weighted dynamically, they're controlled by this key and query mechanism. So you can think of this as a information flow is dynamically gated by the network itself. So these are all inductive biases, and what we want to do in AlphaFold 2 is build physical and geometric insights into the network, not just by processing data, but into the actual architecture so it learns the right thing. And to do this, we want to produce end-to-end system, which directly produces a protein structure. So it has all the gradients, all the right sort of information flowing back to it to produce the best representation possible for this task. And so some of the inductive biases that we put into this network to reflect some domain knowledge about protein physics and geometry is that the position of the residues in the sequence is de-emphasized. We want it to think more about spatial 3D geometry than a sequential geometry on the chain. What we want to do most of all is we want residues which are close to each other in 3D space to communicate with each other more. They need to talk it to each other more so they can like find the right alignment to each other, fit in, like pack into the right space. And so even though but the thing is, we don't actually know what the graph is of the protein. We don't know which residues are near each other at the start because we don't know the structure of the protein. So instead, what we think is the network, and what we want the network to do is to iteratively learn a graph of which residues are close to each other while reasoning over this implicit graph at the same time while it's being built. So down in the corner, you can sort of see a 3D structure and say that these are all the nearest neighbors of this residue with those lines. And then on the right, there's this kind of like pair matrix of every residue, like residue I and residue J, have a sort of edge between them, and we want to have some representation living on those edges. So in more concrete terms, and like what the network actually does, so we have the input sequence to the model. This is the protein we actually want to get the structure for. We throw it into a genetic database. There's the search tools. So we search over a variety of databases using standard third-party tools. And this gives us a multiple sequence alignment, so a set of sequences which are similar to the protein sequence we want to fold. And as I said before, that's important for evolutionary reasons. And then we also have the sequence we want to fold itself, we also put in there. And then we, from the sequence, we create a pair representation. So this is we make a tensor of features which corresponds to what ij is residue I concatenated to residue j. So this all starts off in thinking about these residues being connected to each other. So So then we, next thing we do is that we also additionally search for structures which are similar to the protein. So structures, sequences which have are similar to the protein sequence you're interested in that have a known structure, often they're probably going to be quite similar in structure, so we might as well use that information. AlphaFold, however, can ignore these structures if it wants to. If it, say, thinks the multiple sequence alignment contains better information, it can decide to discount these similar structures, which a lot of other more classical homology modeling techniques can't do. That's one advantage of deep learning. So once we've got these inputs set up, we now kind of have this sort of abstract, we call the MSA representation, which is number of residues by the number of aligned sequences. And then we have what we call the pair representation, which is a sort of a pair matrix of number of residues by number of residues. And then we run Evo4, which is our main sort of block, which is probably where most of the magic happens in a way. And we run 48 blocks of this. And then we get out a new processed MSA representation and a new processed pair representation. From that, we take the first row, which now has all this rich information in it. And we put it in, and then with the pair matrix, we then put it into what we call a structure module. This is a smaller sort of neural network block, which creates the actual 3D structure and generates the both the backbone coordinates and also the sidechain coordinates. Also, things we put on top of the network are a pair residue confidence predictor. So we actually ask the network how confident is it in its prediction? Does it think it's any good? And we also ask it for the pairwise confidence, which is, it's a bit hard to explain, but basically it's how confident is the network in a position of residue I compared to the ground truth from residue J's frame of reference. And what this tells us, probably not going to go into too much detail in this talk, but we have results elsewhere, is it can see, basically it allows us to see which parts of the protein are predicted to be rigid, or we're confident in their relative orientations. So there might be one bit of the protein which is quite a rigid block that we're pretty confident that all of this is in the right sort of position, but we then might have another bit of protein which is just wiggling around. And we're not really sure what the relative orientation of these two blocks is, but we're quite confident in the relative orientation of residues within these blocks. So it allows us to get that information. And these confidence scores are really important for experimentalists and biologists to actually use our predictions, because without these, we wouldn't be able to say, oh, our fold's sometimes right and sometimes it's wrong. This will allow you to distinguish when it's most likely to be right and most likely to be wrong. You probably shouldn't use the structure, and when you should be using the structure, because it's quite confident. So once we've got all these representations, we produce a structure, we then do this thing we call recycling. So we actually just take all of the outputs from the Evo form and the structure, we send them right back to the beginning and run the entire network again. We actually do this 3 times. And we do this kind of, I guess you can think of it as a memory saving thing, because at this point we put a stop gradient on it and don't backpropagate. So we're kind of doing a stochastic backprop of this entire network. So at training time, you roll out for up to 3 iterations, and then the final iteration based on the representation coming out of the previous iterations. And this seems to significantly improve performance, possibly because it's increasing depth, and not backpropagating doesn't seem to harm it too much. So diving into EvoFormer itself, which we're going to have quite a few blocks of, we have this MSA pair representation coming in, and this MSA representation and this pair representation coming in. So we do attention. So on the MSA representation, we do row column attention. So we do a, I think it's called grid rotation or axial attention or something like that. It has various names. So we do attention on the columns, and then we do attention across the rows. And as row attention, we bias with a, we bias the attention logits by the pair matrix. The pair matrix feeds its information in by effectively telling the MSA representation which residues should be talking to each other. So probably the pair matrix has a hypothesis about where which ones are close to which, and then it uses that to bias the information transfer in the MSA representation. And then to get information coming back the other way, we then take this updated MSA representation, which now quite abstract, and we do something like an outer product. So basically we take a quantity which has num residues dimension and then turn it into a num residues by num residues quantity, and then add that onto the pair representation. And that gives information flow in the opposite direction. And then we do an update on the pair representation with something we call triangular attention. So let's go into what triangular attention is. So thinking about this pair representation a bit more, we basically have a graph. So each pixel in this matrix, tensor, multi-dimensional array, whatever, basically corresponds to an edge. So we have a pair of residues. So ij corresponds to the edge between I and j. So we don't need the, we don't know the graph, but you can think of this as a complete graph of all residues. And we kind of have this triplet relation we want to be thinking about. So length three cycles in its graph are quite interesting. What we want to do is update the edge ij, or ik sorry, in the text, based on all cycles involving this edge. So ik should depend on I to j, and then j to k summed over all j. And what this does is that it creates, as I sort of mentioned before, like sort of inductive bias in a network. And one of the big important things is that if this pair matrix is going to represent a, say, a distance matrix, so something in three dimensions, like distances between all the residues, then we want to have properties like the triangle inequality and loop closure as being easy things that are easy for the network to reason about. So we have this, and we found it's quite a good way of updating the pair matrix. So then let's talk about the structure module. So the structure module is on the end of all these embeddings. And this is the bit where we do end-to-end folding. So previously, AlphaFold 1 and other previous protein folding systems often did gradient descent and energy function. So instead, what we do here is we actually have a neural network which directly and iteratively produces the 3D coordinates. And one of the main tricks we do here, which surprises some people, is that we actually abandon the protein backbone. We stop thinking of it as a polymer. We actually chop it up into these gas of three rigid bodies. So taking chunks of three atoms, the nitrogen, the carbon alpha, and the carbon, we turn it into a rigid 3D body. So the network's going to have to learn it. The chain has they go together later. But this has the advantage that we found that forcing the network while trying to predict the structure to always obey the backbone geometry actually prevents it making large maneuvers. It's hard for it to jump to the correct answer when you have this big, long chain with hundreds of angles that you, if you want to say move this one bit, then everything else has to move with it in just the right way. You get lever effects as like small changes to the angle here moves the entire rest of the chain. And we just found that actually reasoning about this as a 3D gas is easier. And then to determine the position of these 3D bodies is that we iteratively update the position of each rigid body using an equivariant 3D transformer architecture. And then finally, it also builds the sidechain geometry. So those are little bits coming off the backbone using by just directly predicting some torsion angles. So you can see there for one of the protein, over the 8 iterations, it actually starts off with a pretty good idea of what the protein looks like. And then over the subsequent iterations, it kind of refines it, it breathes a bit, it compacts it a bit better, and maybe wiggles a few of the little loops around. And then it finally settles down on a structure, which is a bit more accurate. So actually coming out of the main stack, like out of EvoFormer, it actually has a pretty good idea what the protein structure is. You could probably linearly project it off, but this seems to help iterate, it helps to sort of iteratively refine it a bit and give a slightly higher quality prediction. So I mentioned that we use unlabeled sequences for distillation. So we know about this, so 200,000 protein structures in protein data bank, but we actually know billions of protein sequences just without structures. So we'll use this data in two ways. One way is that we do a sort of BERT type thing. So we do a mask language model where we take the, when we give the MSA to the model, we actually mask bits of the MSA out. And then we have an additional head where we ask the model to predict what the value is of the masked out locations in the MSA. And this basically gives the model a training incentive to learn about the sort of correlation structure of the MSA. So basically which bits can be predicted from which other bits. I think we found that particularly helps early on in training. And then the other thing we do is that we use these predictions for distillation. So we train a model on PDB. So we just from experimental structures, we get a version of AlphaFold using that. We then predict structures for a large sequence database hundreds of thousands of protein sequences. And then we, using the confidence metrics that we've created, we filter these predictions by confidence. And we use that, so then we can actually filter down to just the best predictions, which helps us to avoid, basically, I suppose, learning our worst predictions. We don't make the model to overfit on its errors. So you filter for the best predictions, and then you throw that into the training set. So you, with some, in some proportion, I think 75% of the time we train on an example from the distillation set, and 25% of the time we train on a real experimental structure. Those might not be the actual real proportions. I can't quite remember. And this seems to have the effects. I mean, it would be bad if the errors are correlated always with what the model wants to do, but it seems by training, particularly by training a separate model, it makes different errors, and overall distillation appears to have something along the lines of a regularization effects on the network, allowing it to fit better and not overfit the experimental data. So at this point, you might be wondering which part of it matters. And the unfortunate answer is it seems that everything matters. When we ablate various improvements, we find that no single improvement is really dominant. I say like probably the main improvements is the methodology of building intuition into the model, so trying to create these sort of physical biases. And what we find is that if you ablate individual features, there isn't much effect. But if you start ablating pairs of features, then there can be quite large effects. So things have an example here. If we ablate iterative point attention, you only lose a few points, a percent points of accuracy. If you ablate recycling, maybe you lose like 3 or 4% points of accuracy. But if you ablate both of them, you actually lose something like 17 points in accuracy. And I think that's what I'm saying. This is a complex system. Obviously, it's adaptive. It can compensate for missing things. But once you start to remove too many things, they're all propping each other up in some ways. So nothing's dominant, but clearly this is sort of a strong interaction between many of the components. So I'm going to try and describe how we think, or how we've investigated how AlphaFold builds protein structures. So I've talked a bit about the iteration of it. And so one of our best sort of introspections that we did was we looked at, or interpretability investigations we did for the paper was interrogating the network by basically freezing all its weights. And then for every layer, so every one of those 48 layers, an Euroformer times by 4 for every recycling iteration, we project off a structure. So we attach a structure prediction module to the pair representation that particular layer, then try to get it to predict the best structure it can. And basically what this is going to do is going to tell us at that point in time, what information is in the pair representation and how good a structure does it allow us to predict? Like, is it how much processing has happened and how much does it actually know? And at the bottom, you can sort of see a cartoon that the first sort of layer, it might produce something that doesn't look much like a protein. And the last layer looks something which very looks like a protein with like 3 well-packed beta sheets. And in the middle, maybe it's not quite sure yet, but it's starting to produce something which looks a bit like a protein, which is interesting. So if you look at this SARS-CoV-2 protein or fate, which is one of the ones which we were pleasantly surprised actually like a quite nice prediction, you can see that over the 192 layers or blocks, it really does refine, sort of produce the protein structure, reason about it, refine it. You can see it sort of starts out a bit of a mess, but then over time, it starts to stack in and pack the protein together. So those big arrows are what are called beta sheets. And they start to get created, then packed in towards each other. And in some ways, it almost looks like a real molecular dynamics simulation. But of course, this is like just what the content of the neural network is. It's just what it is doing as it is reasoning about how this protein is built. And it's a particularly hard one. So it takes quite a long time, lots of iterations or blocks of the network for it to actually come to the final conclusion. And this is a really big protein, T1024, about 2300 residues. You can see here that right at the start, it starts out this kind of like big black hole. We actually start all the residues out on top of each other. We call it a black hole initialization. But then it rapidly sort of explodes them apart, has a pretty good idea of where they're going. And then once these sort of broad areas are kind of like quite well refined and in place, it kind of sort of is just almost breathing a bit. You see these large scale motions and it kind of jiggles around the protein domains, trying to find exactly the right place for them to go. You can see like a little, on the left-hand side, one of the little blue helices isn't quite sure where it goes. It's quite uncertain. So it's kind of like trying various places for it to pack against the side of the protein. And yeah, so it's very interesting seeing how it's actually thinking, and basically this confirms that it is doing this kind of iterative reasoning process. It does have an idea of what the protein looks like, and this idea gets better over time. And we can look at this quantitatively by looking at the accuracy of the prediction projected off at every layer to up to 192 layers, you can see that with every layer, the prediction quality is basically going up monotonically. And for some proteins, it goes up very quickly. So T1024 was one protein in Cas, which had quite a good prediction, like it is easily able to predict the structure accurately. And it really only needs about 48 iterations or blocks here. So it doesn't really need the rest of the cycling iterations. But T1064, the one I just showed, the SARS-CoV-2 protein, needs all of these iterations. It really takes quite a long time for it to gradually improve the prediction until it gets to its final prediction, basically just squeaks in at layer 192. And then at that point gets a better prediction. And this is something you might, of course, then think, like, this is some, surely why don't we just keep on recycling? And people have of course, looked at this, and I can't confidently say that it always increases accuracy. I think it's quite hard to show that iterating recycling for longer, something I call hypercycling, always gives better results, but it can give better results in some cases, especially where the protein needs more time, the network basically needs more time to think about it. Also, another interesting thing about looking at this graph is that there aren't really discontinuities at 48, 96, 144. It doesn't really seem like the network has much problem transferring the information across these points, even though there are no gradients flowing. Okay, so we've talked a bit about the interpretation of how AlphaFold works, and I'm going to have a sort of go through a bit the impact that AlphaFold has. So it obviously helps when working these sort of problems that to have a clear success metric. And fortunately for us, the protein structure prediction community had created this thing called CASP, for the Critical Assessment of Structure of Protein Structure Prediction, which is a biennial competition, happens every 2 years. And it is a sort of blind assessment of how good your structure prediction system is, which is especially important when you do machine learning models because people can accidentally overfit and all that kind of stuff. And so it only tests people on protein structures which actually haven't been publicly released yet. And so this is a very stringent test. And for a long time, there wasn't much progress. But as you can see, in 2018, there was like quite a big boost of improvements as AlphaFold 1 entered the scene. This is our first entry to CASP. And then in 2020, we got this gigantic improvement, which really pushed the accuracy kind of over the line to the point where actually it's starting to be competitive experiments. And we were consistently top-ranked methods, achieving very high accuracy in most cases. And I guess that's why I'm here talking to you today about it. So it's every 2 years. And so AlphaFold 2 achieves 92.4 GDT median accuracy overall targets, and to be recognized as a solution to the protein structure prediction problem. And here's a couple of examples. So we've always talked about 1064 again, so it's quite a nice one. So ground truth in green and prediction in blue. Here's another one. So this one, again, we talked about the 2300 residue RNA polymerase, which I think one of the most impressive things about this is that actually in CASP, we're actually asked to fold it as individual subsections, so individual domains, you can see in the bottom right, because this is too big usually, but we actually managed to fold it as one gigantic single chain. And the AlphaFold system, despite only being trained on up to proteins up to 512 residues in length, actually generalized okay out to 2,300 residues with some tweaks. So one other part of the impact we've had is that we actually open source the code and the model weights to run AlphaFold. So in our GitHub repo is a copy of all the code and ways and scripts to download the genetic databases and neural network weights. And that allows anyone to run and use AlphaFold on any protein they want and sort of mess with the model. And I think I've seen some really amazing stuff in the community since it was released. I'll maybe show some things a bit about that. Another thing we did, we created the AlphaFold protein structure database. This, I guess, is to say, not everyone wants to install and run AlphaFold on a computer or on a Colab notebook or something. AlphaFold is fast. Why not just predict the structure of loads of proteins, preferably every known protein? So we did this in collaboration with EMBL-EBI, which is the European Molecular Biological Lab, European Bioinformatics Institute, I think, And so they specialize in lossless protein data. They actually host the European Protein Data Bank. So they're experts in this kind of stuff. So they helped us to, helped us to develop this database. And this contains about 800,000 protein structures at the moment, corresponding to humans, so Homo sapiens, plus 20 model organisms of like interesting like sort of mice and E. coli and all that, plus a thing called SwissProt, which is a collection of manually labeled proteins, which are known to be interesting and probably quite important. So that's about 800,000 structures so far. And we intend to expand this to UniRef90, which is a clustered representation of basically all known protein structures in some sense, sorry, protein sequences. So that's going to be about 135 million structures. So that's going to be really huge. But I think that's going to be really cool because, I mean, hopefully you won't have to install and run AlphaFold. You'll be able to just go on this website, type in the name of your protein and see the structure immediately. And I think it's really exciting to see how biologists are already using this in their sort of day-to-day workflows. So on that, about the human proteome, so we predicted every protein in humans, which is called the human proteome, and we looked at how much did we improve it, like how much did we actually learn by doing this. And we found that even when we account for template modeling, which is where you find proteins with a similar sequence with a known structure, and then fill it in, pretend it's like yours, AlphaFold actually significantly increases the high accuracy coverage of the human proteome. What the impact of this will be is a bit hard to say because biology takes a while, medical impacts take a while, but I think it's really going to be really amazing seeing all the insights and maybe even sort of, you know, improvements to insights in medicine that can come from the greater knowledge and not having to spend years doing structural biology to get a hint of what's going on with a process or something. And also should note that we're good at membrane proteins because people often ask that. Okay, so I mentioned earlier that protein structure prediction can actually help experiments. And probably one of the big things is that I still talk about experimental data, but in reality, you actually always have to interpret experimental data. It comes in, say, you know, blurry or like low resolution cryo-EM images. You have a sort of electron microscope image of a protein. These are really incredible experiments that cool down the proteins, stop them jiggling around so much, then image them, then stack all these images. But you still have resolution barriers, and the resolution is always improving, but often the best image you have is the best image you have. And what AlphaFold can do is that something like cryo-EM often knows what the bulk structure is, like the sort of gross topology is of a protein, but the detail's a bit blurry. And AlphaFold is actually very complementary to that. AlphaFold is often very good at the details, and where it makes mistakes, it's not quite sure where the relative orientation of two big floppy bits is. So if you then put that into the cryo-EM density, it can actually often really help to interpret the experimental data. So you can see there, the AlphaFold structure fits in the cryo-EM density nearly perfectly. And another way of doing it, so I mentioned about with crystallography, you have this what's called the phase problem, that you're actually missing half your information. And it's going to be a significant barrier to getting the 3D structure out of your X-ray diffraction data. And ideally, what you want to solve the phasing problem is a really good guess of what the structure looks like. What you do is you sort of take a set of 3D coordinates and then gradient descend it on some, I think, maximum likelihood loss that helps you to learn to then sort of find the structure which is most likely to have been generated by the data. And so previously you might have had to hope you had a really good like template model, so a similar protein of a structure that's already known. But people have found quite rapidly, actually during CASP itself, that our structures can be really quite often useful for what's called molecular replacement, where you actually use them as a starting guess for the refinement process, and that will then help you to interpret the X-ray data. So some people have said they've gone back to data from like 10 years ago that they weren't able to analyze because they couldn't solve phase. And they were then able to use the AlphaFold prediction to then solve it, get a great structure, and then, you know, publish it. So that was one of the really incredible things. That's like probably the fastest bit of, I wasn't expecting experimental like impact to come so quickly, but basically we were told by the CASP organizers, like, we're so surprised by your results that we had to go check with the experimentalists, and they hadn't actually got the answers yet. So we actually found that they, we're able to use your prediction to get to a solve their data, which is really cool. Another thing we found is that when AlphaFold is not confident, actually this corresponds to something which might actually be real. Often it's not confident because the protein doesn't have a structure. So lots of protein structures have what's called intrinsically disordered regions. So these are regions which don't fold to form proper structures. And actually this is, often people don't appreciate this very much because they don't show up in experiment very well, but huge amounts of proteins are actually intrinsically disordered. I think some, like maybe a third of the human proteins are have intrinsic disorder, or residues are. And so actually we find that low confidence of AlphaFold is actually a very strong signal of disorder on a par with existing, or maybe even better, I'm not really sure, than existing disorder predictors. That's very interesting. So something that AlphaFold wasn't really trained to do, turns out actually it's quite good at. And generally there's been, you know, a huge reaction from the community of sort of people picking it up and using it and applying it to all their problems, solving their old data, finding ways for it to use for hypothesis generation. So looking at, oh, this protein binds to this protein, but we don't know the structures. But if you look at the AlphaFold structure, you can see that there are these residues here. So if you mutate those, they'll affect the binding interface, and they might cause it to like not bind or something. So like people are starting to do biological experiments using AlphaFold structures as for hypothesis generation. People have also been playing with the code quite a bit. And one thing they found was actually that you can trick AlphaFold into folding multi-chain proteins. So most of you've been talking so far about single chain proteins, but actually lots of proteins are made of multiple protein chains which fold up together. Turns out AlphaFold, if you put in either a big sort of junk linker region or hack the features of it, you can actually trick it into predicting multi-chain proteins, which is quite funny. Which gets me onto the next section, which is about AlphaFold Multimer. I'm just looking at time a bit. And this is a quick update we kind of did in October, where we actually train it properly. So the bunch of people have been sort of hacking on AlphaFold and getting it to predict these multi-chain proteins, but actually we felt that the right thing to do is to go back and retrain AlphaFold properly on multi-chain data with the right features. So it actually handles multi-chain proteins from scratch for sort of properly. We found this actually gave quite a big boost in accuracy. So some of the other methods are there. Another previous non-AlphaFold based multi-chain protein method called ClusPro is there in green. And you can see that AlphaFold Multimer, the pale blue on the left bar on the left, is significantly better than all of these on this DocQ score, which says how good is your multi-chain protein prediction. And on the right, I've given a bunch of cherry-picked examples from the paper showing how we predict some really, I think, quite beautiful structures of these multi-chain proteins. And to have some limitations, so one thing we notice is that compared to AlphaFold just hacked up, it gives significantly better predictions for what proteins call heteromers, where you have two different protein sequences as the two different chains, or more than two different chains. And it gives a small improvement, still some improvement on what are called homomers, so proteins which just made a change with the same sequence. It's probably because AlphaFold can actually impute loss of missing context by itself. And so even while folding a one chain out of a homomer, you could probably actually guess that the homomer had some partners that were missing and impute them, and so actually make it still look quite an accurate structure, even though physically it shouldn't be able to. So some limitations of AlphaFold Multimer is that it requires you to actually know how many chains there are, like know the stoichiometry. It seems to perform poorly on antibody interactions. And also one thing we found is that it's not a great low confidence on a sort of structure prediction. Isn't a great sign of a non-interacting pair. So one of the things people would really like to know is like which proteins in a human are interact with each other. So you think, okay, what we need to do is just fold every pair of proteins together. But it seems like that's low confidence isn't necessarily a good indicator there that two proteins don't interact or not. So it's still new work. I think sort of the multiple system is at a earlier stage, you could say, than the single chain system. But also it's to some extent the case that the multimer problem is a more ill-defined problem. Knowing what the exact correct multimer state of a protein is probably not as well-defined as the folder state, in a sense. So, drawing into the sort of end of the talk, I just want to sort of mention a bit about what's next. So these aren't necessarily things that we would work on, but these are broadly the things I think are next in the areas sort of structure prediction, and particularly as we talk about deep learning and machine learning applied to structure prediction. So we want to increase the multiple accuracy. And I said, and then thinking about the human structural interactome. So if you increase the accuracy, can we actually start to predict which proteins in an organism interact with each other? We can also extend the system to work on things which aren't proteins. So nucleic acids are just another type of polymer in a way. And proteins often interact with and form complexes with nucleic acids. So the ribosome, the thing that actually in your body that creates proteins, is itself a complex of proteins and RNA. And also you want to know what the structure of proteins is when it binds to a drug molecule. This is very important for drug discovery. It's called the docking problem. And where a small molecule docks or binds to a protein is interesting because it will block or promote some sort of interaction that the protein's involved with. And knowing how that works will help you design molecules which will be better drugs. And then also one thing is that proteins aren't just these static rigid structures. You've seen them jiggling around a bit as AlphaFold folds them, but also in nature, they jiggle around. They're thermal, they're big, these big floppy things. And actually proteins have conformational diversity. Usually experiment, you'll see probably something that corresponds a bit to like a free energy minimum, but there'll be a bunch of other states. And often these states will be affected by mutations. So the relative population of the might change when I mutate the protein sequence, or if it interacts with, say, a drug molecule or something. Another one is the structural metaproteome, you might say. So basically expanding the AlphaFold database to cover almost all known protein structures. So that's going to be about 135 million, 100 million sort of range. And also think about how we can actually build tools to make this useful. So bioinformatics is traditionally based on processing sequences of proteins. But imagine what we could do in bioinformatics if every single protein sequence you look at comes with a structure. I think that's really interesting. And then finally, as I was mentioning, conformations, mutations are very important. So understanding disease often involves understanding what the effect of mutation is. So there's a mutation in a gene, gives this change in the protein. How does that mutation affect the structure and stability and function of the protein? And that can help us understand disease. And just to give a sort of more perspective outlook on sort of the future of AI for science, I think there's a really great potential for building like these very highly optimized ML systems for scientific problems, as with AlphaFold. And really AI can be the sort of ultimate tool to help scientists see farther. I think there's a bunch of lenses in which you can see AI for science. You can maybe categorize them a bit in sort of data-driven things, a bit like AlphaFold, so uncovering patterns in data sets, like experimental data sets. There's things like accelerating simulations. So people use ML to try to, say, speed up, say, fluid dynamic simulations. There's using ML for function approximation. So these deep neural networks are very good function approximators. So some of the work of DeepMind listed below is things like using deep neural networks to represent many body wave functions. So in that case, it's not even trained from data. It's just using it purely as a function approximation. So also we have here like learning from simulation data, so improving density functional theory. So basically where we already have a heuristic that we have to kind of learn, we can actually improve that heuristic by using a neural network. There's another one, GLASSY systems. So that's using neural networks to explore and understand simulation data, to understand phase transitions in GLASSY systems. There's this genomics work we do on understanding gene expression. And then there's the maths work we've done. So this recent paper where AI is actually used to guide human intuition. So discover patterns in mathematical objects and then use that to guide humans to actually produce interesting theorems. So yes, that's kind of in a sort of search and using AI to search better. I think AlphaFold is in a sense, I think just the start of the impact that AI is going to have on science and really how we're going to leverage AI to enhance human intelligence in this entire discipline. So on acknowledgements, these are lots of people at DeepMind and Emble EBI who worked on AlphaFold and the AlphaFold release. Should also thank the CASP community for creating a really good benchmark test that I think helped at least convince people that we'd solve the problem. And of course, the experimental data the protein data bank. So this experimental community has been working for years to build up this really amazing resource of experimental structures, and also most importantly, free release them so that people can analyze them and build on them. So that's the end of the talk. I think we now have some time for Q&A. I've got nothing after this, so happy to chat for at least a few minutes.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. I'm sure we already have a few questions by people raising their hands, and I think another one in the chat is being modified. So Jude, I think you were first. Please do ask your question.
Yeah, thanks. That was a really, really interesting talk. I really enjoyed that. And I was particularly interested in this recycling mechanism. So I understand you've got these kind of multiple representations of the protein structure inside the network. You've got like the pair representation, the sequence alignment, the multiple sequence alignment representation. And in the structure module, you also have these like the rotation and translation that actually encodes the position of the kind of residue gas fragment. And which of these representations are actually recycled, or are you generating a protein structure and then recomputing features as a template? Or yeah, if you could elucidate, that would be great.
I think we put all of them back in. So I think we add the abstract features back onto themselves at the start. And then we might encode the structure that's predicted back in as a, I don't think it goes in as a template, but I think it goes in at some point. To be honest, these are the sort of details which are probably best found in either the open source code or the paper. Because the code's probably the most accurate, but the paper's also very good. We have a 60-page SI which has all these details in pseudocode. I think we put all of them back. Of course, then there were like interesting variations, like do you just put the structure, do you just put the representations, which one's better? I think the intuition probably is you probably need the structure at least for the moment without some other compensating changes, because the structure has the side chains and some other information there which might be useful. Like the structure is probably a little bit better than what's in the pair representation. But overall, I probably think most tempted to think of recycling as a trick to increase the depth of the network.
Brilliant, thanks, that's really helpful.
Right, I think you can go, Will.
Yeah, I was just a little interested in more the kind of process of how you designed AlphaFold. Were a lot of these updates kind of iterative? Were you testing it on, say, a chunk of it and finding a flaw in it and then adding in some kind of domain knowledge, or did you have a kind of big picture in your head of what you wanted to go for?
Oh yeah, really interesting question. I think, yeah, you're right. We kind of developed iteratively. I think you could kind of look at the end result and kind of see that it's been developed iteratively. The main way we work for a lot of the AlphaFold development is sort of leaderboard-based development. Is that we know we're aiming towards CASP, so the protein folding competition, and we think that's a good benchmark. So we, as you develop it, you sort of train on the structures, and then we held out a test set of the CASP proteins, or actually all proteins after a certain date. And then we fold that test set continuously, and we basically have that as a team infrastructure and team goal, is basically to increase that accuracy on that leaderboard. And basically, I mean, a lot of the time we just had a hypothesis like, oh, we need more inductive bias on this thing, or covariance tension will make this better or something. You put it in, train it, doesn't improve on, and then ultimately see it doesn't improve on the leaderboard. And so a lot of what we did was sort of leaderboard-based development. And sometimes you step back and then actually started looking at structures and saying, oh, this thing isn't doing this thing for this reason. And that might give you a hypothesis for what you need to look at next, that, oh, it's missing this because it's, oh, this sort of information channel doesn't exist, so we should add a better information channel there. Or one thing you actually do is that sometimes you actually analyze what is the network trying to do. So like after 64 layers or whatever, what representation is it built up? And can we actually find a way for it to earlier on do that sort of faster? So one trick you can do while developing a scale network is looking at the attention maps inside the network, and see, you can see like which residues are trying to talk to each other and can we make it easier for them to talk to each other, like reduce the signal to noise ratio in that sort of communication.
That's a brilliant answer. I just want to know from a machine learning perspective as well, whether you feel we want to maintain humans in the loop here, or do you think that will always be a necessity, or do you think that part of this kind of drive is phasing that out?
Do you think, are you talking in terms of like auto ML type ideas?
Yeah, so kind of you're continually looking at it and improving it from a human standpoint.
Yeah.
Do you see that as a process that we'll always need?
I think it's an interesting question. In my view on auto ML is that auto ML seems to like historically been better, like it can refine and improve existing architectures, like, you know, find some funny ways to make a update or something. But, you know, AutoML that works on ConvNets didn't suddenly step back and create transformers. It's still quite hard for AutoML to do that, and that might be you might call that an AGI hard problem, like that sort of level of sort of leap of faith or generalization or thinking patterns create that. On the other hand, my thought would be that there's what we've seen in things like, you know, really huge language models is that inductive biases and things seem to become less important the more data you have. So it might be that when I have a really huge network, possibly not just training on protein data, imagine I was doing something ridiculous like, you know, training a language model on both Wikipedia and proteins at the same time and like a billion other things. Maybe that one network can actually learn to do all of these things at once, and the information flow and the way it learns to reason means it can, it needs very little human guidance to do all those things at once. Of course, the main place that humans will still come in is humans are needed to define the objective. As you know, with any optimization problem, you will eventually start to exploit the score and you will no longer actually be doing something useful. And what you really want to do is make sure your score that you're trying to optimize is aligned with the task, the business case, like what you're actually trying to do with this. So I think that's another reason you generally always going to need humans in the loop. To keep things aligned with what you actually want them to do.
That's exactly what I was looking for. Thank you very much.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you, Edith. We have another question from Art Louis.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, good. Super. So just a quick technical question that I missed in your talk. So presumably you use some kind of force field presumably at the ends to refine your structures. Is that right? Or is it all bioinformatics all the way through?
So it's two things we do to improve the structure. So at the end, we put on a force field like loss, which penalizes the network when the bond lengths are incorrect or atoms are overlapping. That's a loss on the neural network. And then another thing we do that generally removes most what we call structural violations. So violations of stereochemical properties. Then another thing we do after that is we actually do then run a bit of gradient descent on the final structure with a OpenMM amber force field. And that produces like very small changes. We actually restrain it to the predicted structure. That cleans up a few of the small, like, you know, slightly wrong bond lengths or something, or like a few overlapping atoms. And generally, we just do that so it will show properly in PyMOL or something. It doesn't give any difference in accuracy. Generally, I guess the problem is that optimizing these force fields isn't predictive of protein structure generally.
And there's no water in this final step.
No, I think it's amber 99 SB, which is a implicit solvent force field. If I remember.
Super, that's helpful. Thanks.
Yes, we can. Peter Bram has a question for you.
So first of all, Tim, I want to thank you for an absolutely fantastic talk. It seems to me, looking at several of the results from DeepMind, we've had the pleasure of hosting you a few times over the last 3 years, that you generally work, you know, with a substantial team, and also you take a very deep and liberal way of thinking about problems, like you described in this talk very well in the beginning, I think. Do you have some thoughts about how the more traditional graduate student in a university could also get sort of optimal results in this area? And can universities actually learn some important lessons from DeepMind's structure as sort of an academic inspired new kind of company to join you in blazing the trail?
I think it's a very interesting question. I'm sure Demis, our CEO, has lots of thoughts on this. I think in terms of advice for graduate students, I think similar to like what DeepMind does, if protein structure prediction wasn't going to be solved in some sense by deep learning, we probably wouldn't have done it. So, because our strengths are in sort of computer science and deep learning, and we also bring in some domain knowledge from say from physics and things. So I think one advice would be sort of stick to strengths. Like DeepMind tends to be quite focused and do these big things. There's often less, say, totally blue skies, crazy investigations. There's often like much sort of more driven problems, maybe on trying to tackle more root node problem. But also as a grad student, you have quite a lot of freedom to investigate very different things, drill down, maybe go after problems which don't have to be still very useful. Like I think as a graduate student, my area I worked in NMR wasn't very competitive. Like there weren't a huge number of other students working, like competing against me on it, but I was able to make quite a nice niche that was actually very useful for lots of experimentalists. But I think the main problem to me, I think this probably gets into things that graduate students themselves can't fix, but maybe universities can fix. So one example for me was the existence, I really like DeepMind's research engineer position, is that scientific software engineers for a long time hasn't been a very well-developed career track in academia. I understand it's getting a bit better recently. I've seen the Royal Society of Research Engineering and that sort of thing. So that's one thing, is a lot of modern scientific problems involve strong computer science and software engineering ability to solve, and research groups can benefit from having those skills present. Another one I think is probably the hardest one to solve in academia is this incentives problem, is that DeepMind can sort of form teams of people who are motivated and aligned to all work together on this one big project. And I remember when at the AlphaFold conference, even the first one, the PIs we spoke to were kind of amazed that we managed to get sort of six people to work together for a couple of years on one problem. Like that's actually quite hard in lots of academic situations. And you know, because people want to graduate, they want to write their thesis, everyone wants to first author paper. You have, we often find in our team that writing papers is a massive, takes a lot of time, and you actually quite like just be moving on, but academia incentivizes you to take cuts and like decide when you're going to publish a paper. So I think that's one thing, is that working out how to align incentives, possibly, I don't know, more institute type structure that allows people to collaborate on bigger projects in a way that like respects their contributions or something like that. I think that's probably the sort of ways I'd be thinking. I do still think there are different strengths and benefits to both ways of doing things.
Thank you. I think it's a very clear answer. You sort of particularly mentioning these longer lived, bigger teams, the impact of computer scientists, and then the selection of the problems. Yeah, that's very, very clear. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Right, I think Patrick Brennan has a question, and then we have two more questions in the chat.
Hi, thank you very much for a great talk. I was just curious whether DeepMind had any thoughts about training AlphaFold using nucleic acid sequences as opposed to amino acid sequences. For example, looking at how the choice of codons and how that affects the actual translation of the protein could be used in structure prediction.
Okay, so not predicting nucleic acid structures, but actually inputting the codons rather than amino acid sequence. We have, it came up sort of earlier on, I think quite early on in the AlphaFold 1 project, we sort of were idly musing about this because we didn't really know much about bioinformatics. But I think it turns out, other people might know this better, is that a lot of these databases of protein sequences don't come with the codon sequence. My understanding is often they're sequenced from nature, where someone's just found a protein, you do reverse transcriptase, and then that's, so you actually don't have the original coding sequence that the protein came from. And that means that, say, these MSAs don't come with the DNA, that the codons come with them. I think the information often just isn't available. But I'd be very interested, like, probably is research looking at this, that certainly you would think that sort of correlated mutations might be more obvious if you were able to look at the actual bases that were mutating rather than just the actual overall effects on the common broad score, where it actually changes the amino acid in the end. I suppose the one thing there is though, that evolution is ultimately selecting for the amino acid, not the codon sequence. So you can imagine, I guess, as a Markov chain, maybe those two steps really just collapse into one, what the overall effect is on the mutation rates. I think so, I've read some stuff that actual codons can affect some things biologically. Like, it can affect transcription rates, I think, and like how fast a ribosome works. But those might be quite subtle effects. I'm not really sure. I think, for example, if I remember, like, part of these mRNA vaccines that have been produced, some of the optimization there was caused codon optimization. But those are probably details that don't matter if you just want to actually get the structure, not sort of work out how it's getting produced by the ribosome.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, Nid. So I'm going to read the two questions in the chat so that they are part of the recording. So the first one is from Greg Collier, who is asking you, can you compare the output against a local physics model where the large discrepancies may indicate that the environment has a significant effect? For example, when the in vivo structure worked on by evolution may differ significantly from the isolated structure or crystal structure.
I think the problem here, this is kind of what I alluded to when about saying minimizing the amber, like the force fields, is that local physics models are less accurate than AlphaFold. So we have actually found that where there are disagreements, and this actually even happens at the experimental level, that sometimes when there are disagreements between AlphaFold and experimental structure, it is at the level of this could be a crystal artifact in the experimental structure. So for other people, like in a crystal, you have a lattice of proteins, and these proteins are artificially packed up against each other. And so like a loop in one protein might be folded down to avoid contact with another protein. And that would be an artifact that was just due to how it crystallized or this particular protein. I think the answer would be that we can't use local physics models because physics models are generally worse than AlphaFold. But the discrepancies do happen with experiments, which are sometimes in AlphaFold's favor due to these in vivo differences, like solution state versus crystal state and all that kind of stuff. And even if you look at, say, NMR, NMR isn't usually solution state. And even there, you can get differences. Actually, recently, there have been some papers that have found that AlphaFold structures are usually better fits for the NMR data than the solved NMR structure. So we're kind of getting to that range where, like, we're so accurate, sometimes the experiment's wrong, which I think is a great place to be as a theorist.
Yeah, I guess I was wondering whether if you can eliminate the discrepancies that are not crystal artifacts, then might that tell you what the active part of the protein is? Because if you know there's something else there, and you know that it's not another part of the same protein that's coming from the crystal, then it must be something else that's there in vivo, maybe.
Yeah, I can see what you mean. Yes, I suppose one example here would be that sometimes, so I mentioned AlphaFold can often impute extra missing context. So for example, you often get these transporter proteins which have a pore in them, and oftentimes these pores have like a drug molecule jammed into them. And that will force the protein to be in a certain conformation. So this is the first protein in CASP. Actually, it could either be like this or like that. And which one it was, it turns out that actually it was in this position and there was this big molecule down the center of it that we hadn't been told about. And and similarly, there will be other things like, so in a homomer with several other proteins, if you look at the structure, it's clearly non-physical because you have these, like, say, large greasy parts of the protein, which are apparently, according to AlphaFold, just open to water, but actually AlphaFold realize it's a dimer and actually will be pairing up with itself to not be exposed. So at that sort of level, I can imagine you could use physical models to try and see if there's a discrepancy, but there's still the problem, like, I mean, molecular dynamics is too expensive to run. Like, how would you, you basically have to run molecular dynamics on the protein long enough to show that it predicts something different. At that point, you might sort of think that maybe you should have just run, if you could afford that, you should just run molecular dynamics in the first place. Yes.
Could you just do like an equilibrium calculation? You don't need the dynamics because you've already got to the end point, as it were.
Equilibrium with, you don't know the free energy function of these proteins, so you, it's hard to just jump straight to the answer. I mean, that's kind of what AlphaFold's trying to do, is jump straight to the equilibrium answer, whereas molecular dynamics is, yeah, trying to sample equilibrium with the Markov chain.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I think that there is potential there for looking for where's the discrepancy, because AlphaFold isn't fully physical because it's learning from the statistics of the data. Cheers.
Right, thank you. Kyle Duffy has three related questions for you. The first one is, how did you settle on the number of evoformer layers? The second one is, have you observed any trends in accuracy with input sequence length? And the last one is, following the high-level understanding of stacking evoformers as reasoning about structure, do you think deepening the model on more complex inputs, effectively allowing to reason longer, would significantly affect performance?
The number of evoformer layers, I think it ends up being a trade-off between, when you're training machine learning models, what you want is a turnaround time where it doesn't take forever to train. And also there's memory limits, so we're training on TPU. So, you know, you're trying to fit the, even with rematerialization, you're trying to fit these things into memory. I think we found that possibly going up to 64 layers didn't give any noticeable increase in accuracy at the exchange of much slower training. So I think it was roughly on those lines, or that recycling gave a better improvements by effectively increasing the depth while being faster. Trends in accuracy with input sequence length. The problem here is that the accuracy measures themselves are a bit sequence length dependent. So you imagine for longer proteins, they're more likely to be a bit flexible. And so the accuracy over longer distances is gonna be lower. But there are some ones which are more like local estimates of accuracy, like what's called LDT. And I don't think we really see a huge difference in accuracy with longer sequences. Maybe it goes down a bit. Possibly our papers will have a plot somewhere of accuracy versus length. Probably, I mean, the biggest thing that affects accuracy is the number of aligned sequences. So long as you've got about 30 aligned sequences, we can generally give you a very good prediction. Probably also the big difference with long sequences is that there's one thing with long sequences, as you get above a certain length, proteins tend to be built out of what are called domains. And these domains basically form compact structures themselves. They kind of, one of the definitions is they fold independently. And that means that they don't have that much effect on each other's structure. So they're largely, if you fold one accurately, that sort of, you can be accurate no matter the length of the protein. The main challenge is in terms of like memory, like our attention scales cubically with length, which isn't so great for speed of really huge proteins. But we find we can fold up to about 2,700 proteins. I think we've had previously during CASP, we mentioned it in our CASP paper that we found that the really long protein, that 2,300 residue protein, sort had something what we kind of call long chain collapse, where it seemed that for longer proteins, it got less accurate. But we fixed that by just fine tuning AlphaFolds with slightly longer crops of the protein at training time. And that seemed to correct for whatever misapprehension it had. You might imagine it hasn't seen the position coning out far, or it hasn't really, it's a bit out of distribution. I wouldn't be surprised if at even longer protein lengths, there are evidences of long range collapse where it's a bit out of distribution for what it's been trained on. Sorry, the other question. Deepening the model, more complex inputs. I'm not really sure what you mean by more complex inputs. I mean, deep networks, I think, should generally just be on the raw data. But yeah, I think better architecture, like still trying to improve and refine the information passing in it, possibly, you know, who knows, sparsity or something like that could help. And generally, we know in deep learning that deeper is better, stack more layers, all that kind of thing. And so I would think giving the model more ability to think about it and reason for longer would possibly increase performance. Though, as I said, we're starting to, at least for single chain prediction, bump up against the experimental accuracy, really. So there might not be huge amounts of extra performance to get. Who knows, I probably will regret those words at some point.
Right, very interesting. Thank you for your detailed answers. We still have two other questions, and I was wondering if you have some time to answer this question. You're sure? Okay, perfect. Thank you. It seems like your talk generates a lot of interest. One of the questions from Maya was, what are some other scientific problems that you think can be solved with AI in similar methods to AlphaFold? And I'd like to ask if you think any advancement in the field of astrophysics could be something studied.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, the similar methods to AlphaFold, I suppose one way of thinking that is things with lots of data. So protein folding is admittedly like a area of like very rich set of experimental data, which have been curated for a long time, we know is useful. But hundreds of thousands of samples isn't actually that huge in the grand scheme of things. So certainly like astrophysics is an interesting one. I know there's some papers from the Flatiron Institute where they, is it Shelley who, where they say run large scale universe simulations with different, say, cosmological like lambda CDM parameters, and then try to, you know, simulate observations and then try to back out of those to predict the lambda CDM parameters from the observations, which is quite very interesting. So obviously lots of things in biology where just sort of better and faster image processing and pattern recognition would allow you to probably handle bigger and bigger data sets. There's, I think, probably like a quite a big thing which I feel hasn't really been quite cracked yet is simulation. So how to speed up simulations. So quite often when people talk about, say, neural networks speeding up simulations, I think you often find that, you know, they can simulate 64 times fewer steps, but at the cost of 256 times more compute. So you kind of think, okay, we haven't really managed to amortize the cost of the simulation into the neural network. But that's one of the things where I think if you work it out right, maybe some of these big costs of simulations could be amortized by a neural network in some way. I think that Jennifer mentioned climate issues, like that could help speed up climate simulation or something like that. Though I suspect the real climate issue is probably people and politicians rather than simulations. And yeah, I think anything which involves lots of data and lots of compute can ultimately benefit, because another way I think about neural networks is they help us to like compress data and find shortcuts for how to extract information and process that information.
Interesting, thank you. And our last question is rather technical from Nelly Quast. She starts by thanking you for the interesting talk, and I think we can all join in that. And she's asking you if the distribution of the equilibrium structure given the MSA is now encoded in the train AF network, do you see a possibility to invert a structure to receive a distribution of a sequence in which specific amino acids and their positions are weighed by importance for that structure?
So I just have to think about it. And this is one interesting point, actually, I should probably say that when you vary the, sometimes when you sample, you fold one protein several times with AlphaFold, it does produce some slightly different structures, and sometimes you can actually produce like flip into a different mode. So it does seem like AlphaFold does sometimes know about different modes of the distribution, but just haven't really worked out the right way to ask it to give us all the modes at once. But in terms of inversing the structure, so I guess this is kind of getting to like protein design. So people do have done work which is effectively this. You take a protein structure and then make a neural network which, say, with a, you know, an autoregressive language model or something, generates a sequence, amino acid sequence, and which you then sample to get a generative model sequence, which would perhaps fold up to give that protein. Obviously you have to make sure it's not a trivial problem, because if I knew exactly where every atom is in a protein, I could just read off exactly what those amino acids are. And you also get additional things where, like, even if you say sensor the side chains, you can only see the backbone, I can still kind of measure the volumes of every round of every residue and, you know, use that to work out what the amino acid is. So there's lots of ways to trick the problem of going from structure to sequence. probably the most useful way actually is people generalize it to kind of like topologies. So you say like, I want three helices with this topology, and then try and sensor all the other details, the actual structure. But generally that's kind of called protein design. And probably the main way people actually do it is they just randomly change the input sequence to a model like AlphaFold, look at the output structure, and then say do some sort of metric comparing the output structure to the structure they want, and then do a sort of, you know, simulated annealing where you just randomly replace, you mutate the input sequence until you get a structure that is similar to the one you want. But there's lots of ways to do that. And I think, yeah, protein design is a unsolved problem right now. Probably because protein design requires you to have a neural network which probably knows more about protein physics than AlphaFold does. Like, it's probably more sensitive to the actual conformational distribution and more sensitive to mutations than AlphaFold is right now.
Thanks.
Thank you indeed. And thank you for your talk. It was a fascinating experience to jump into AlphaFold with you, and thank you for the time you took to answer so many questions.
Brilliant, thank you. I'm probably going to be in Oxford in a month's time, and 25th of February. So if anyone's interested in meeting, I can probably, I don't know about timings yet, but I think I might be able to. So yeah, email the tfgg at deepmind.com if you want to meet, and I'll get back to you about whether I can fit you in.
Very interesting. I'm sure you're going to have a few emails. Well, thank you everyone for joining, and thank you again, team, and for presenting this very interesting work.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Have a good afternoon, everyone.
Bye, everyone.